It is an absolute honor to interview William Henry today. William, you are an author, you're an investigative mythologist, and you're a TV presenter, including Gaia's Ascension Keepers. Mm-hmm. So I'm really fascinated to have a spiritual discussion about what it means to be a sentient being mm-hmm. today. What does sentience mean to you?
Well, when I think about it, of course, sentience refers to feelings. And I come largely from a mystical perspective, especially the Jewish mystical and Christian mystical perspective. And in that tradition, they tell us that originally humans were not in a flesh and blood form. That originally, when we dwelled in the Garden of Eden, which they think of as a place of pure light and pure love, we were beings of light. This is what, like the Zohar says and other mystical texts. Then after the fall, this is when we get our flesh and blood bodies. Now, this is really important because, as I understand it, light beings don't experience sentience like we do. They, for example, if you think of a light being, you're often going to think of an angel. Well, angels don't have sex. They don't marry. They don't experience what we experience in our flesh and blood bodies. And it's only with our flesh and blood bodies that we have sensors. We feel, we hear, we see, and this causes emotion and enables us to then feel things. So on the one hand, we're taught that the fall was a negative thing. In other words, we came from another realm and then now we're in this dimension, if you will, in one of these things. And according to the Christian mystical tradition, the Jewish mystical tradition, all of human history is about transcending the flesh and getting back to our original status as beings of light. So what that would mean then, it seems, is that we would let go of all of our feelings, let go of all of the things that we experience in this realm. And what's paradoxical about it is that the way they tell us to get back to our original light being status is through love. So it's kind of confusing in that way. That's why I say it's paradoxical that at one time we didn't have, we had this exalted light body, but we couldn't love the way we love in our physical body. And now all of a sudden we find ourselves in one of these things, walking around in this realm for entertainment, work out karma, maybe as a messenger of our creator. Nobody can say exactly why a soul incarnates, but most certainly one of the benefits, if not the purpose of incarnating in a flesh and blood body is to experience sentience, to experience feelings.
Yeah. From your extensive research in ancient history and alternative ancient history, what do you think is like the number one takeaway that really supports the argument that our feelings are an interface to higher levels of consciousness?
Just the fact that they talk about love and human interaction so much in these traditions, that this is the source of life itself, that is the spark of life. So based on that, I would say that is the core teaching.
So I love that. So we've sort of come to a point in the conversation where we're on life force. Mm-hmm. This life force was something that almost dimmed out in me mm-hmm. because I had such a difficult battle with alcoholism. Mm-hmm. I found my way back to the light, but that was a really brutal experience. Mm-hmm. What happens to us when we fall that, you know, obstructs us or stops us from being in full contact with our sentient beings?
I think I subscribe to this general metaphysical notion that when our divine spark, our soul incarnates, takes on this body, in fact, some believe manifests this body as a vehicle for exploration, that there's a wiping of our memory, a past life memory of our connection with source. And I think we do that in order to fully experience this realm, make it fresh every time. I mean, who knows? I mean, some people believe they've been on Earth 10,000 lifetimes or more, going round and round and round, trying to get it right. And one of the keys to awakening, they say, is we have to remember, at least from the Gnostic perspective, they say we have to remember our true self. That, first of all, our flesh isn't true. It's an image of our true self. And the self that's on earth is only a fragment of a greater flame or fire that is our true self. So these are, in the Gnostic mystery schools, these are the keys to awakening.
Yeah. Wow. Fascinating. Mm-hmm. So how do we use our sentience as a gateway to ascension?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, it's about love is the key to ascension across the board. That you're going to hear that from the Christian perspective, the Jewish, Islamic perspective. They all say the same thing. Love with all your heart, your mind, your soul. Love your neighbor as yourself, that quantum principle. So if you are incapable of love, then logically that says you're incapable of ascending. And that sounds kind of cold and harsh, but that is, if you read it, the letter and the spirit of what these texts are saying, that is what they're saying.
So many people find it difficult to love themselves. What would you say to them?
Well, then you can. You have the capability of doing it. All of us have the capability of doing that. We're genetically created. Within our DNA, we have the codes. We have the capability to love. And it's just finding the right way to express that DNA. It's like music. I mean, there's how many different types of instruments on the planet? You might not play the trumpet, but you could be a great guitar player. So it's a matter of finding that one area that opens it up for you. And there always is one key that can unlock the whole door for everybody.
I'm interested in your faith-based approach to spirituality. How important is it to have a faith to engage in devotional living?
Well, I think it's very important. I am actually a cherry picker. I weave my way through all religious and spiritual traditions. And I'm comfortable in doing that. Other people, not so comfortable. They want to pick a lane, stay in that lane. And often Buddhism tells you, do not go outside the path. And other traditions suggest that as well. But I like the kind of the interconnected approach, because I'm looking for commonalities in the different traditions and looking for the way that they all ultimately express the same truth, that we are beings of light and love originally, and we are here to share love.
Yeah, that reminds me, there's a yogic teaching that if you practice these traditions, you turn emotional commotion to emotional devotion. Mm-hmm. And I like that. I'm a cherry picker too, by mm-hmm. the way. And yoga mm-hmm. was one thing I turned to, Kundalini yoga specifically. Mm-hmm. We've actually interviewed a spiritual leader in that tradition mm-hmm. Who talks a lot about, you know, emotions as a gateway, but also what trips us up a lot is the negative emotions. I mean, is there intrinsic value to the negative charge?
Well, I mean, it's all energy and motion, right? I mean, it's on a spectrum, but it's ultimately the same thing, right? I mean, love and fear are intertwined. They're two sides of the same frequency or vibration.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's choosing one over the other that is ultimately free will for us. Every moment we know we bring all of this to life in our imagination, and every single moment we have a choice. Are we going to choose love or choose fear? That's what this planet's about. And I think that's why we incarnate in this realm. If you ask me bluntly, why are we here? And I think it's to learn to choose love over fear, because those are frequencies, those are emotions. And if we can't control it in this slow down world, how are we going to do it when we get into an accelerated world? So this to me is like a sort of a cosmic kindergarten for souls to come here and learn to navigate the world of our emotions and be a sentient being.
Yeah. The value of life, going back to that concept, mm-hmm. I'm interested in the idea that I'm a microcosm of the macrocosm. And if I do the work and find my way to love, mm-hmm. as you say,
right.
Then is that affecting the collective?
Absolutely. I'm a huge believer in the Buddhist story, the Mahayana Buddhist story of Indra's net, that there's this vast net spread throughout the universe, Indra's net, and that at each junction there's a jewel. And whatever happens to one jewel on Indra's net, it's reflected in all the jewels. I love that concept, because it says, hey, you know, we're all a jewel on this net. And as we allow the light through us, it ultimately affects all the other jewels in the net. In Islam, they have a concept that we're all particles of light or rays of light from the sun, and that we're all collectively the sun. And what we have to remember is that we are that ray of light from this magnificent greater whole.
Yeah. What about the creational properties of emotion? Can I create my own reality through what I think, feel, believe, say, do? How does that work?
Absolutely. This is the great miracle of our time, is the discovery of the power of feelings to manifest our reality. And as more and more people start to tap into that, it's going to become a more natural and common human trait. We all use it anyway, whether we're going to be conscious about it or unconscious. And of course, it's better to be conscious about the power of our feelings and how they help us to manifest our reality.
I'm so glad you said that, William. And it's funny because to me, that is like a wow concept. That has pizzazz. Mm-hmm. But yet, if you say your emotional intelligence, it's not very sexy. People don't want to talk about emotions.
Right.
You know, it can be a drag
right. To
have these things. But the potential to work with it is infinite. Why do we do this as a species?
I think it's just our culture that we have this programming coming from a control mechanism, some sort of power structure on the planet that denigrates feeling. Big boys don't cry is a good example, right? And to disavow our feelings is a way of coping. And then that cascades into a much bigger problem in our lives, because now we can even lose touch with our feelings and our sentience. And it is, as you've said, it's a very long road back to that place. But what is shifting in our culture is an acceptance of the inner power within us and the ability that we all have to transcend the limitations of our flesh and blood bodies. And again, the way we do that is through our feelings, our emotions.
I'm happy we came to a place where we can talk about the manipulation a little bit. Mm-hmm. Are we manipulated by a control system through our emotional body?
We're constantly manipulated mentally, physically, spiritually, but mostly emotionally. This is what advertising is based on. They're trying to get an emotional response, especially an unconscious emotional response. And so it's worked beautifully from a business perspective, from corporations. They're master manipulators that way. And part of what we got to recognize is this is the power that they're using against us. And we have to take back that power.
Yeah, it's all about taking back that power. Mm-hmm. Do you think that the opposite of sentience is AI?
I think artificial intelligence is our great awakener. As I like to tell people, for the past 10,000 years since the last great flood, the last great climate change catastrophe, humanity has not had a predator. Except ourselves, right? We either do ourselves in or we try to do our neighbor in, right? But we don't have an outer force like a saber-toothed tiger that is hunting us for breakfast, right? But AI is our predator now, because AI is taking the steps to become, or we're enabling AI to take steps to become effectively our master, where algorithms will be making decisions for and about us, even without our knowledge. And so what we've done then is taken the human power structure on the planet and turned it over to a machine, to algorithms. And what's crazy about that is that we're now trying to assign or be coerced into assigning or perceiving, as an example, a robot has emotions and feelings, and that we could hurt a robot's feelings. You see all kinds of advertisements now starting to appear about this, where they're assigning emotional qualities to inorganic life forms, robots, AI-infused life forms. And children today are being raised by boxes, by their devices, by Alexa and these devices. They're reading bedtime stories to them. They're starting to have emotional bonds with them. And they're being conditioned now that these devices are things that we can love and have relationships with, including now for adults, sexual relationships, even marriages with robots. And we're starting to say, oh, these new beings, these artificial entities have feelings. They have personalities. They have spirit. And my thinking is, no, they do not. They do not. And to coerce children into believing this is criminal. Any corporation that is involved in this needs to be put out of business, because it is torture in a way, what they are doing to these children, getting them to cuddle up to their the new toy that looks like a teddy bear, but it's actually got some form of intelligence in it. It can read the child's facial expressions. It knows its name. It can answer questions for it. And this is just the beginning of what is going to happen over the next decade or so, where literally parents will be replaced by robots. And now the kids are being taught, manipulated, programmed to believe that these robot supervisors, which is what they are, prison guards in a way, somehow are emotional, and that you could hurt the feelings of this robot if you don't love it or do what it says. How can we have a civilization based on that principle? I mean, where are we going with this?
No, I totally agree. Can I ask you to say in a succinct soundbite something about sentience and AI so I can kind of link it and intro into what you've just said?
Through movies, advertisements, culture, we're being programmed and conditioned to believe that artificially intelligent entities like a robot have sentience, that they have feelings, that they have emotions and personalities, all of these human qualities. But the fact is, they do not and probably never will.
It is a massive threat. What is the antidote to the threat of AI?
The antidote to the threat of AI is to raise our ascension intelligence, our angelic intelligence, to tap into our innate spirituality and to recognize that what AI is offering to us is simply a simulation or a fake version of what we can all do naturally and organically. We can increase our intelligence. We can have psychic communications. We can do all of these things organically that AI is trying to replace.
Man, it's a cheap imitation, isn't it?
Yeah, AI is just, it is. It's a cheap imitation of humanity. And the threat with children is that they are being programmed, conditioned to believe that AI is their friend. And it's not. It's actually a predator.
We see it everywhere now. It's it's an epidemic.
It is.
Much like addiction.
AI is the greatest humanitarian crisis ever because it could bring about our extinction and our replacement, even within the next decade.
Wow.
It's nothing to be messing around with.
No, absolutely. I'm really grateful that you're raising our awareness, and we'll try to boost that as well in this film about sentience, about the value of living, the gift that we are given to wake up and have this awareness.
Yeah.
I mean, it's insulting as a human to have a corporation tell me they have created a device, a tool, an instrument, a machine that has the same feelings and sentience that I do. It just does not. And to assign those qualities to it is, I just say, I think it's criminal. It's anti-human. For certain. And it's anti-sentience. It's another way of wiping feelings off the planet, because what a robot is going to experience is not true human emotion, true human sentience. It's an imitation of it. And what they're going to be showing us is that really humans, to live with AI, will have to merge with AI. And what that means we're going to have to give up is our own sentience in order to coexist with a machine that has no sentience, that has fake or imitation emotions or sentience.
And it has to be stopped.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah, absolutely. I want to bring it back to the angelic realms and the higher sentient states. You talked about developing our subtle senses, psychic intuition. Are these real? Can I actually access them as a human?
Mm-hmm. Everybody wants to know, how can I develop my higher spiritual capabilities of, say, my psychic abilities or manifestation? I mean, they tell us that humans innately have the ability to manipulate matter, to walk through walls, to fly. And this sounds absurd to talk like this, but this has been so well documented in all the mystic traditions. This is what a fully functioning, in fact, a normal human being can do. We're not normal. We've been conditioned to accept that an inferior life is a good life, that not developing your abilities is actually the safe way to live, because otherwise people are going to think you're weird or something. And so it's been drilled out of us to feel or experience or develop these capabilities. But yet that, once again, is the only way for us to ultimately transcend this realm, is to reclaim those abilities and to accept them.
Yes, 100%. That's what it's all about. And hopefully, if we can harness that, we can head towards ascension as a humanity, one soul at a time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Brilliant. Do you have anything else to add to the conversation?
No, nothing I can think of. Does that help?
That is brilliant. You gave us some awesome sound bites.
Yeah, okay.
Perfect. And thank you for using the word
sure.
in there. Awesome. I didn't want to be too directive, but
it's nice
for me if
it's
I can
important.
Plug it every once in a while. Yeah. I mean, obviously, we sort of use it interchangeably with consciousness and emotions, but it's different.
I like it. No, it's much better.
Yeah.
It is much better.
I became obsessed with the word.
Because, yeah, I mean, like, not to pick on anybody, but I heard James Redfield say, consciousness is contagious. And I didn't, so what does that mean?
Yeah.
I didn't really get it.
No.
You know, where if you put it in the line of sentience and feelings, and that makes a lot more sense.
It makes a lot more sense.
That is contagious.
Yeah, and I just want to put it on the map. I want to say, define it for yourself.
Right.
You know, here's what we have to offer. Here's this perspective and this perspective. And
right.
Bring it into the conversation.
Right. And I think what people need to think about is, can you imagine a world without feelings?
Yeah.
That's a world without sentience. That's what we're creating. So.
And what does that look like if we were to follow that path to the end?
Well, yeah, if we follow that path to the end, we're just looking at a Borg-type existence, just a machine-type existence.
Terrifying.
Yeah.
Well, thank you.
My pleasure.
For this conversation
thank
today.
You
Do you have anything
brilliant.
You wanted to ask?
Absolutely brilliant. Yeah.
I really appreciate it.
My pleasure.